We gather in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you. Amen. Those words mean so much to us this day as we gather in grief. I welcome you, Peggy and Eileen, and all your family, and Oliver, the favourite outlaw, and the niece, Susan, and nephews, John and Aidan, and especially with the grandnieces and nephews, all who are so dear. Not just ye, but all who lived on the lane, all who were colleagues on the journey of life with her. Symbols are put before us, because we can't have two very special people with us this day. Well, not people, but very special spirits to her, and they were her pets, her dogs. And so we have an image here, a picture of Sandy and Brandy. Bailey, I nearly got. Sandy and Bailey, and I'm sure that they shed their own tears this morning. And also we have the fork and the trowel from the garden that she so tendered and looked after and is in such beautiful blooms at this time. But especially to tender to the needs of the people who are residents in St. Mary's and with the image of Our Lady here on this little table of display as well. And we think of all that she has cared for and looked after along the journey. Now God will look after her forever in that eternal embrace. Our sadness is illuminated by this Paschal candle, the symbol of Christ, our risen Saviour. In that we find confidence. That's why we're here. And so we prepare ourselves to seek, as we heard in that opening hymn, the amazing grace of God to help us as we must continue. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us one day to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. O God, whose nature is always to forgive and to show mercy, we humbly implore you for your servant Olive, whom you have called this day to journey to you. And since she hoped and believed in you, grant that she may be led to her true homeland, to delight in its everlasting joys, through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
And please be seated for the liturgy of the word, and invite Susan and Emma, I think, to lead us in the readings.
A reading from the Book of Wisdom. The souls of the righteous are in the hand of God, and no torment shall ever touch them. In the eyes of the foolish they did appear to die, and their departure was taught to be a disaster, and their going from us to be their destruction, but they are at peace. For though in the sight of others they were punished, their hope is full of immortality. Having been disciplined a little, they will receive great good, because God tested them and found them worthy of himself. Like gold in the furnace he tried them, and like a sacrificial burnt offering he accepted them. Those who trust in him will understand truth, and the faithful will abide with him in love, because grace and mercy are upon his holy ones, and he watches over his elect. This is the word of the Lord.
Leads me by the still, still waters. From the second letter of St. Paul to Timothy. As for me, I am already being poured out as a libation, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day, and not only to me, but to all who have longed for his appearing. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please stand. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I am the way, the truth, and the life, says the Lord. No one can come to the Father except through me. Hallelujah.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
On arriving at Bethany, Jesus found that Lazarus had been in the tomb for 4 days already. Bethany is only about 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to sympathize with them over their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus had come, she went out to meet him. Mary remained sitting in the house. Martha said to Jesus, "If you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now, whatever you ask of God, he will grant you." "Your brother," said Jesus to her, "will rise again." Martha said, "I know he will rise again at the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. If anyone believes in me, even though he dies, he will live. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" "Yes, Lord," she said. "I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, the one who was to come into this world." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
The Lord's Holy Gospel for our sins. And please be seated. This gospel recounts the sad reality of death in a family. We are familiar with this family, of Lazarus, Mary, and Martha, and of their friendship with Jesus and his disciples. Theirs wasn't much different to you, the Black family, or any family. Just 2,000 years might separate us, and loads of modern stuff too, but still the effects of being born and dying remain the same. The joy and the sorrow of life in this passing world. Theirs was an ordinary story in an ordinary week, but Christ transformed an ordinary event into something out of the ordinary to foreshadow the ultimate shattering of death's grasp when God would raise the Lord's own body from the tomb. And so it is that we look back to the gospel times to make sense of our own time and place. The events that make the headlines and the more personal ones, which won't cause much difference to the wider community. We gather because the one that you have loved has died. So much has happened in a week. Yes, you knew all of us becoming weaker, but still we never know the day or the hour when God, the giver and receiver of our lives, takes our breath away at that time when the journey is complete. Being able to gather with all of at home was indeed a privilege. A privileged blessing, as we think of so many during this awful pandemic who couldn't be as close to their loved ones. As the eldest, Peggy, you sort of led the way for your double troubled pair of sisters, Olive and Eileen. But in this act of life, it wasn't possible to lead. The death of a sibling is naturally tough, but I dare say even more so when it is a twin. Eileen, you've truly been stuck together all your lives, but now it's a different story, a different journey. Yourself and Peggy accompanied Olive to the end with faith, hope, and enduring love. Christian virtues and values which were instilled from your parents and the folk before them. Now things have changed, but not ended in the relationship which bounded you so close here on earth. For Olive will continue to watch out for you from heaven as you so diligently did for her here on earth, especially so in these recent times when the burden of illness became almost too much to carry. As you well know, we honour the martyrdom of St. Oliver Plunkett on the 1st of July, and being born on the 3rd of July, your parents chose to call one of their twins Olive. There was no martyrdom, thank God, for your Olive, but she too emulated this good saint of our land in the giving of herself, not just to you, her beloved sisters, nephews and niece, grandnephews and nieces, but also to dear friends, neighbours, and tirelessly to the residents and colleagues in St. Mary's. I know it's a coincidence that her parents, and I'm not sure whether it was Molly or Peter, too died on the 11th of a month. But the 11th of August, on which Olive died, is the feast day of St. Clare of Assisi, Santa Chiara. She was a young woman who felt inspired by others, in particular, our good friend Francis of Assisi. And she felt called by God, too, to serve those most in need. Olive, it can be said, did the same. Indeed, as a young woman, she explored dedicating herself to religious life with the Little Sisters of the Poor. Her mother, though, encouraging, knew her beautiful red-headed daughter better than Olive knew herself and predicted her strong-willed attitude to obedience might sooner rather than later bring about a return home. And so it came to pass. Yet that inner religious remained in Olive, and through all of her life, she devoted herself to God in prayer and through her good works. You recount how, after Olive's schedule of a long day's work in St. Mary's, she wouldn't rest for her days off, but instead head off up to Rockborough Road and volunteer with the sisters. Over the years, your Olive just had a capacity to be there for those who had no one, so often whispering the reassuring words of comfort to the dying while holding the lighted candle in their hands as she got others around to recite the prayers, even the lads at work who mightn't have been so on for remembering all those words. She got them to participate, for she was a straight talker, giving it as she saw it, and you all know that, be you a relative, friend, colleague, or stranger. I even believe St. Oliver's successor as Archbishop of Armagh got an audience with Olive on the streets in Lourdes, and she wasn't shy in sharing her views to him either. Olive had a direct line to God. I'm sure even God was told some home truths. But as a Christian, as a committed follower of Christ, Olive was confident that God answers requested prayers, not always as we'd seek, but with the graces required to cope. Indeed, Olive herself needed abundant grace to cope in recent weeks. As there was moments she doubted, and it was you, Eileen, who reassured her that God was close. In a sense, your Olive entered deeply into that humanity of Christ when you imagine the agony in the garden the night before his passion and death on Calvary. As the angel came to our Lord's aid, many angels came to Olive's aid, disguised as the helpers and palliative care team, along with you, Deirdre, and Mrs. Cooney, and extended family. But it was her team of saints who interceded for her, the same team of so many saints such as St. Martin de Porres, St. Padre Pio, St. Bernadette, and St. Oliver, to whom she implored for all her intentions throughout her 74 years. The altars and loads of religious images at home bear testimony to her strong faith. At home, I won't say Olive was the quiet one, as I believe, Eileen, you're both well able to keep the chat going amid the smoke. But you both weren't ones for heading out too much either. Olive just preferred being home with the dogs and the cats. In recent years, Bailey and Sandy, I nearly got wrong there again, Bailey and Sandy were her pride and joy, but the cats got well looked after too. I'm not sure Susan, John and Aidan, where you came in the pecking order, but I know she loved you dearly and the next generation too. She'd you all well spoilt. Though I dare say, if you're helping out in the garden, She was able to tell you if you're doing the task in hand right or wrong. Auntie Olive's example, apart from the cigarettes, has certainly made a good impression upon you all. And she'd simply encourage it and say, keep and share the faith in Christ Jesus, which meant so much to her. Speaking of doing things right, Olive wasn't the most eager for doing the cooking, Eileen, but I've been told she'd often remark about the taste, and you'd promptly respond with the invitation to cook the dinner herself the next day, if the standard wasn't up to her palate. Olive wasn't one either for modern gadgets or having a face stuck in the smartphones, as is the modern trend. For her, the youth of today seemed so connected, but not as able to communicate for older technology. Olive was one for proper communicating and giving her full presence to whomever she was engaged with. Indeed, she has kept correspondence and regular contact with friends, even from her short convent days, and colleagues from years ago. The hearing of Olive's death will be sad news for them, as we think of Sister Bernadette and others who might not have heard yet, especially so in these restricted pandemic times. We think, too, of those joining in via the broadcast for whom it wasn't possible to travel to be physically present with you, Peggy and Eileen. Olive loved being out in the garden, but her green fingers also planted the beautiful flowers along the laneway. Perhaps doing her bit to counteract the effects of climate change when you think of all those cigarettes she smoked. But among the shrubs are the in-flower fuchsia, or as we in Ireland commonly call the Dora Day, God's teardrops. Peggy and Eileen, God weeps with you. Jesus, as we know from this gospel, knew the tears of this world and is close to you now, as he always is for those who bear witness to his holy name. As he came to the sisters' tearful eyes of Martha and Mary, he comes in Holy Communion to you to console and to strengthen you. And you too, Oliver, and the whole family, as you gather with us, the family of faith of this parish. Last Thursday, I brought Holy Communion to Olive, and she simply smiled at Jesus. It was extraordinary. We witnessed it together, Eileen. Olive believed in his presence here and at home. Now we come from home to this sacred place, for we believe, we know the risen one. We know, like the believers in this gospel, that Olive is not dead, but now alive and gone before us into heaven. We trust in the merciful love of God our Father, and we pray that he may count Olive among the saints in his heavenly embrace, uniting her with her parents, with Molly and Peter and all the faithful departed whom she loved. And so we pray, the Lord answer us. Amen. I now invite Holly, Zoe, Jack, Lorraine, and John to lead us in the prayer of the faithful. And let us stand. And so, Holly, I'll get you over here. We'll use this mic for you. And so, Father in heaven, you know the thoughts of our minds and the beat of our hearts, we ask you now to heed our prayers as we remember Olive and pray for us who must continue on our journey.
We pray for Olive who has died. May God now welcome her into his heavenly home of eternal happiness and peace. Lord, hear us.
Lord, gracious, hear us.
We pray for the relatives and friends of Olive, especially her sisters Peggy and Eileen, brother-in-law Olive, and the members of her extended family, her neighbours and friends. May God fill their hearts with his comfort and consolation. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for all those whose lives are dedicated to caring for the sick, and in particular, we pray for the carers, palliative care, oncology nurses, doctors, and all who cared for Olive during her illness. May God reward their goodness and kindness. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray in thanksgiving for our neighbours and friends who have been so kind to us during the time of sadness. May God reward their kindness and bless their homes with happiness and peace. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for all those who have died, especially Olive's mother and father, and all her relatives and friends who have gone before her. May God unite them all in the happiness and peace of his heavenly home. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us. And we think of those who are unable to be here physically with us, especially our grandnephew, I think, who's in Portugal at this time. And we pray for all of them who grieve now for her along with us. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
And together we turn to our Heavenly Mother and we pray. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thine, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Make all our prayers through Christ, the light of our world. Amen.
Amen.
And please be seated. Thanks, everyone.
You shall cross the barren desert, but you shall not die thirst. You shall wander far in safety, though you do not know the way. You shall speak your word in foreign lands, and all will understand. You shall see the face of God and live. Be not afraid.
Sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be made acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all his holy church.
As we humbly present to you these sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your servant Olive, we beseech your mercy, that she who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Saviour may find in him a merciful judge who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim.
Sanctus, Sanctus, Sanctus Dominus Deus Sabaoth, plenus angelii et terra, benedictus qui venit in nomine Domini, Hosanna in excelsis.
And let us stand for the celebration of the Eucharistic prayer. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather people to yourself. so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we brought you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith.
Save us, Savior of the world. Save us, Savior of the world. For by your cross and resurrection, you have set us free. You have set us free.
Therefore, O Lord, we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven. And as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with St. Oliver and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for your unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis our Pope and Tom our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. We especially think of their family and friends who are unable to be here physically with us, but are sharing through the broadcast in the spiritual communion. Remember your servant Olive, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that she, who was united with your Son in a death like his, may also be one with him in his resurrection, when from the earth he'll raise up in the flesh those who have died and transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed brothers and sisters too, especially remembering her deceased parents and grandparents and relatives and friends, and to all who are pleasing to you, Lord, at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages, and praise you without end, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow in the world all that is good. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours for ever and ever.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Say this man, formed by teaching, he dared to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, and graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the risen one be with you always.
And with your spirit. Agnus Dei, qui tollis peccata mundi, miserere nobis. Agnus Dei, qui tollis peccata mundi, miserere nobis. Agnus Dei.
Behold the Lamb of God, the risen one. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof. When you say the word, my soul shall be healed.
As a wondrous attraction.
Stand and pray. Lord God, whose Son left us in the sacrament of his body food for the journey, mercifully grant that strengthened by it, the one we have loved, Olive, may come to the eternal table of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. I'm sure there's plenty of thoughts going through your mind as you listen to that beautiful post-communion hymn of Our Lady of Knock. Just comprehend that it was on an August Saturday evening that the apparition took place, and the feast will be recalled this coming week. And please God, during the summer, if any of you are down there, light a candle in memory of Olive and for Peggy and Eileen to give them grace and strength at this time. Our Lady is close. We trust in her as she points us to her risen Son. And And so to you, Peggy and Eileen, and to Susan, and to Uncle Oliver, and to John and Aidan, to all of you, our sympathy and prayers of support at this time. And on behalf of the whole community, be assured of our prayers in these days ahead. I know so many came to your aid in recent days. We thank them for that. We thank so many who helped us here today, members of the family, who helped us with the beautiful readings and the prayer of the faithful. A special word of thanks to Joe and the sacristy and the team here, and to Joe on camera, and to Timmy for the beautiful music that has raised our whole spirits to God in communion with our faithful departed and with all of this day. A special word of thanks too to all the undertaking team as well. And so we pray. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us bless the Lord. And let us have our prayers of final commendation. Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of the one we've loved. May our farewell express our affection for Olive, may it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we should joyfully greet her again with the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. Receive her soul and present her to God the Most High.
Receive her soul and present her to God the Most High.
Saints of God, come to Olive's aid. Hasten to meet her, angels of the Lord.
Receive her soul and present her to God the Most High.
May Christ, who called you, take you to himself. May angels lead you to the side of Abraham.
Receive her soul and present her to God the Most High.
Eternal rest grant unto Olive, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon her.
Receive her soul and present her to God the Most High.
Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend the one we've loved, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, all will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which bestowed upon all of in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn towards us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant Olive, and help us to remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ, and we're with you and with the one we've loved forever and ever.
Amen.
Olive, may the angels lead you into paradise. May the martyrs come to welcome you and take you to the holy city, the new and eternal Jerusalem. In peace, let us now take Olive to her place of rest with her parents in the cemetery beside us.
I lost some wonder. Christ shall come, which shall